Well, today is the day, everyone. Tomorrow Air Show, here at the Tomorrow Aviation Museum, where we have some Marine Spitfires. So this won't just be any plane spotting video, but an air show as well, plus a museum tour as well. So yeah, I'll see you guys in a bit. Here's what a flight attendant looked like in World War II. Gloucester Meteor F8 is what this one was, what the specific model is. You see it's got old turbojet engines, right here. There we go. That was loud but amazing, to be honest.
It is, eh?
But you want something? But if you think that's loud, then imagine this one.
Yeah. Oh,
man. You wanna know why? Because of that engine there.
Yeah. So you can
believe it or not, I've actually seen one of these in person again.
You eject this, see Johnny.
All right.
I'm pretty sure that's a turbojet engine.
Hmm?
It's a turbojet engine.
Yeah.
Well, they use for fighter jets. This is a piston engine. Yep. Dad.
This is the boomerang. Suzy Q. Flying this okay. They don't even have a roof. You open puppy. It's the Tiger Moth.
Thank you.
There you go. I think
it's almost to the day, 10 years ago.
This is the traditional method of starting aircraft. It goes all the way back to the early days of aviation. Some people call it the Armstrong method. That's very obvious to you.
Thank you.
Trained out here. Well, basically, it was basic military training in addition to the basic flying training. There is a model that the museum has showing what the layout of the entire base was. It's taken from the plans of the base. There were a lot of hangars over there. There were parade grounds. There were rifle ranges. Everything that you could think of in a military base was here. And there were about 2,400 pilots trained here during the war years. There were a number of these elementary flying training bases around Australia. And of course, when you left here, you were fully qualified to fly an aircraft. Then you would go and do your advanced training. I'll just listen as the Ryan STM takes off. Companies not only in England but also here in Australia, in New Zealand, Sweden, Norway, Portugal, Canada. Structural member, wooden rings to give it the shape, and again, some of the
rips him off. And that aircraft had a lot of pioneering flights in the interwar period. To use the aircraft as a trainer was a little bit difficult because the DH-60, the wings were stacked one on top of each other, which made it very difficult to get into the front cockpit. So you can see on this aircraft, the wings are staggered forward. And to keep everything in balance.
Well, of course I was home at 4:30.
As you can see, these aircraft look similar, but they are radically different. Products of the Ryan Aeronautical Company in the United States. And not a lot of people know about the Ryan Aeronautical Company. And one of their products in particular was an aircraft called the Ryan Bowler. Now that doesn't really ring any bells, but if I said the school of St. Louis, you would know, because that was the aircraft flown by Charles Lindbergh across the Atlantic. Ryan also manufactured quite a number of different aircraft, and they wanted to get into the sport touring line.
They needed to get pilots trained very, very quickly. So they produced a modified version with 160 horsepower Kino radio, 5-cylinder. And you can see the wind. About 1,048 of these,
out of the total production of just over 1,500 of this rowing series. You also see that the undercarriage is not bad, it's a lot stronger. That's the aircraft being flown today by Ben Blatter. The Cessna 170, a four-seat touring aircraft. In the First World War, aircraft were used originally for forward air control, which is a modern term. What they used to do is fly over the enemy lines, wave at the German aeroplane that was going over the British lines, take photos, observe the locations of the troops on the ground, and report that back to the artillery. The same thing happened in World War II, where it was called Army Cooperation. And in World War II, those aircraft aircraft like the Piper L4, known as the Grasshopper, which was basically the Piper Cub, two-seater, tandem. Taylor's after produced the Oster for the British, using large numbers. Those aircraft were very difficult to maintain, so the US wanted something that was made out better. They put out a competition, and it was won by Cessna. The aircraft was designated in the early 1940s. And that bird dog was bestowed after a competition amongst Cessna. Now this truly is the mouse that roared. It has the same tail and the same wings as the Cessna 170, the same controls. The fuselage is modified for tandem two-seat. The visibility out of that aircraft is incredible. The first one flew in 1949 and straight away they were sent to Korea because the war broke out there in 1950.
Quite a number of Australians were seconded to the US
US Army to fly these machines. And they were mostly jet pilots, which seems a bit stupid. Why would you put a jet fighter pilot in one of these? Because the aircraft that they were calling in to bomb the targets or to protect a guy who may have ejected on the ground, they knew what the capabilities of the aircraft were. They knew what they could carry. They could see where the enemy was, they could call in jet fighter bombers, they could call in the old prop-driven aircraft like the Sky Raiders that they had up there. One Sky Raider, single engine, one pilot, could carry more ordnance than a four-engine, 10-crewed B-17 of World War II. So that would give you an idea of the capabilities that these aircraft could call in. They were also used in some clandestine operations, and if you've ever read a book called The Ravens, which is a story of the war in Laos, and that war was going on in Laos right next to Vietnam for 5 years before the rest of the world knew anything about it, and they operated out of secret bases here. Chicago O'Hare Airport, and people knew nothing about what was going on up there. So if you get a chance to read that book, The Exploits of the Guys, the CT-4 Airtrails, owned by Sam Gavassa Costa, also a member of 100 Squadron. And it was the Air Cruiser, which was a four-seat, larger version of the Artura. The Artura's looked at that straight away, thought this would make a very good basic military training aircraft. So they set about modifying it, strengthening it, turned it into side-by-side two-seat, like the Artura. And they immediately had sales for it, the tyres bought them. And even though we decided we weren't going to subsidise the manufacture of the aircraft here in Australia, the RAAF for RAAF Army and Navy pilots, very simple to operate and solid, but it actually got the name the Plastic Parrot when it went into service. Why? Because the aircraft that it replaced, an aircraft produced by the Commonwealth Aircraft Corporation here in Australia called the Windjill, which had a big 450 horsepower radial engine, fixed undercarriage, tail wheel, very solid machine. And the guys that flew it in and went to tail wheels. Green and bright yellow. So the term Plastic Parrot stuck. The scheme that you see the aircraft flying in now was the one that was adopted later on, and it is more high visibility. It was actually trialled on a Windjill before that type went out of service, and they called it the Fantacan scheme for obvious reasons, orange and white. Thank you.
The first was an initial order.
So these are
PC-21
turboprops. It's actually my first time seeing a single turboprop engine up close. It feels weird standing on the tarmac as well. So these are our last two planes for the day.
Yeah.
because you didn't need something complicated if you were teaching someone to fly for the first time. You added steps in on time. In the Tiger one, for example, they didn't even have a radio. They had a crossboard tube. Rubber tubes that went from the front to the rear cockpit that basically yelled into a mouthpiece that was like a hot water bottle top. And the other end went into the instructor or the cadet's headpiece. It has a constant speed propeller that you have to adjust between takeoff and cruise. It has radios. Because it's heavier, it has greater inertia, so you have to respect the aircraft a bit more. They built just under 11,500 of these during the war, and they were the SNV to the US Navy and the BT-13. VT basic trainer. Now, these aircraft were seen all over the United States, from east to west coast, north to south. The engine, extremely reliable, Pratt & Whitney R985, radial 985 cubic inches. And these were the aircraft that really trained the pilots how to fly. The problem was that during that training, a lot of them thought that they were better than they were, and they exceeded their capabilities, not the aircraft's. And so it did get a bit of a bad reputation. The aircraft was also known as the vaulting vibrator, because in certain flight regimes, like near Stor, the canopies used to rattle really badly. Post-World War II, the aircraft went out of service. Now, I mentioned earlier on the Empire Air Training School, the reason for being in Tamora. And this was the advanced trainer for the Empire Air Training School for the Commonwealth countries, and also for the US Army Air Force and the US Navy. Some of these aircraft were used by the US Navy for actual earlier carrier qualifications. Some of them were actually fitted with a tailhook and landed on these small carriers that were in the Great Lakes. As an advanced trainer, this was again a heavier aircraft. It had a higher performance engine, 600 horsepower, compared to the 450 horsepower of the BT-13. And it could also be used for armament training. Fixed forward firing machine gun that could fire through the propeller arc. And it also had the capability of carrying what they call light series air show in New Zealand. Used by over 60 different air arms, 60 different countries for training. And with that Empire Air Training School, we didn't use the Harbour here in Australia, we used its cousin, the Wirrawa. The lead aircraft is part of the 100 Squadron. It is a former Kiwi aircraft. That is Dave Salter's machine that just peeled off. He's going for individual display. The second, or the trailing yellow aircraft, is brought up, owned by the Steam. Number of machine guns. Used in the combat or the different brush wars in Angola
Mozambique. These aircraft are still doing what they were originally designed for, and that is to train pilots to fly more advanced aircraft. So they would go from the Tiger or the Ryan into, say, in America, the B-213, then go into the T-6, and the step up from that was they were graded as to their ability, whether they would go on to bombers, transports, fighters, and obviously the best step up that you could have would be either into a Spitfire, a Mustang, or a P-40. And that is what the aircraft are currently being used for in the United States, to train people to fly these very rare aircraft. I think the purchase cost of a flying Mustang to the government in World War II was something like about $75,000. Now they're worth about $4.5 million.
Listen to the bell.
able to fly the Lockheed U2 spy plane.
Thank you. 656 of these. Second aircraft, second Spitfire, Satin and
these aircraft have a great start connection. The Mustang was built by North American Aviation, and the only other country in the world that built it was Australia, CO Silver. The one with the American markings, the yellow checks on the nose, is actually North American Aviation built one, built in the United States.
Royal Australian Air Force loves to show off their planes, don't they? They really do, and that's obviously a good thing. Why? Because I'm an Abbey, so. You really get to see this one.
That big plane is moving as well.
You can see there. I like how some of them actually do have the paint, the scary faces painted on them. I've always wondered what was the idea behind that?
To scare the enemy.
So just basically just clever ideas. That dude there's gonna take off pretty soon, I'm pretty sure of it. What aircraft is that? They're not too bad when they're taxiing, but when they take off, when they're flying, it's a different story.
What?
The And that really gets me questioning, I wonder how loud these blokes are going to be when they take off. The answer is probably very loud.
Yeah, look, pilots are putting earplugs in.
So you can tell this is a loud engine. Like, it won't be too bad when, like, you won't actually get a flight when it's going to start up, because the nice thing is because it's a gas turbine, so it'll know. Because, you know, you can hear the...
Look there, Johnny.
I think these guys are going to start up pretty soon. That's why they wear the helmets for ear protection. And that's why they wear the helmets, okay? Because these aren't as thick as the commercial airliners. So that's why you don't wear them on the commercial airliners. But with smaller aircraft, you have to wear ear protection.
Go.
inside of Portaloo, as you can see. Just show you what they look like on the inside. There's the sink right here. Of course, this here will flush it. So yeah. So I'll see you guys in a bit. That's him.
Yeah.
You know what I reckon? I reckon he's gonna... Mom, I reckon he's gonna go from there to just fly past here.
He's going that way now. He was just staying out of the way until the planes land.
So therefore he can fly over? Is he going to fly over?
Yeah, I think so.
Are you sure about that? Yeah, it is him. Getting closer. You can see he's getting closer.
Mark Benchman.
Yeah, I'm good.
Not very noisy at all.
No, it isn't. That's the idea. Yeah? It's supposed to hear them coming.
That's a turbojet engine, isn't it?
Yeah.
Is it a turbojet?
It looks like it.
Hopefully the next air show I go to will have actual, will have the modern day fighter jets.
Do you know who's flying that airplane?
Yeah.
The XCDF.
This one actually, this model aircraft actually shares the name of my home city. And it's not very loud either. Well, that's officially the quietest fighter jet I've ever seen. Bomber. Bit small for a bomber, isn't it? And that time it was really low to the ground. I told you it was going to be noisy because it's a turboprop. You can see the smoke.
Now this is the RAAF for Defence Force training.
Got a window seat.
And we replaced another PC.
Thank you.
Yeah, you can see the turbo in the jet engine. Over there.
How many hours would you expect to gain on the PC29?
Well, that wraps it up, I guess.
Very precise handling.
So, yeah, that's about it. When you go to these events, make sure you wear your ear protection. And I'll see you guys next episode. Goodbye.